We're going to set up my three chairs again, and he's been, and the three chairs, most of you have seen me demonstrate this, demonstrating spirit, soul, and body. And I'm going to review a little bit, and the phrase that kept flowing through me today, even before I came, and then especially hearing how the Lord was using Nathan. The phrase is the saving of the soul. See, we were born again instantly. We're going to demonstrate that here in a little bit. The moment you get born again, your spirit goes from death to life, from darkness to light. Ephesians chapter 4 tells us that new man that's created on the inside of you, the instant you get born again, two things. He's created after God, and that means in his likeness. And the second thing is righteousness and true holiness. Now that spirit man has a voice. That voice is your conscience. And that's what Nathan was teaching on this morning. And we're going to illustrate that even, I think, in more detail. And let me mention this to the cameraman. I'm going to be down there a lot. Please unzoom. Is that a word? Unzoom enough. It's more important that the people be able to see the chairs than they see my face. Okay? So once we get down there and start illustrating this. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yes, sir. All right. So let's review a few verses here real quickly. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Verse 23, I'm going to give you time to look at these. Yes, sir. Okay, all right. He's already starting something different. Let me tell you how this is why we are spirit. The verse we're going to look at is where it says, I pray God your whole spirit, soul, and body. See, from the word of God, that's how you even know that you are a spirit. You have a soul, and you live in a body. The world doesn't understand that, and we don't understand it without the Word of God. See, have you noticed we're all integrated into one? You ever tried to leave your soul at home and come to church? You know? I mean, you know, we're one. Because we're not separated out, you know, well, we have problems. And we think it's just me, you know. I was I'd read the Bible in Romans 6, and it says, well, shall we continue in sin? Remember, I was smoking. I'm picking on that one because that's the one, you know, it's easy. Everyone can see it. It's not one of those hidden things like gossip and envy. I'm not looking at anybody now. Smoking's real obvious. You can tell, you know, it's kind of hard to hide, okay? Alcoholism would be another one, okay? But with me, it was the one that lingered for so long was smoking. So I'd read Romans 6. Shall we continue in sin that grace shall abound? Puff, puff. You know what the next words are, right? It's so heinous, the thought, that all Paul can say is, God forbid. And I'd go, yeah, I know. Puff, puff. For the life of me, I couldn't figure out, though. Because, well, maybe I'm not saved. No one else ever had that thought. You're struggling with something. Well, maybe I'm not really saved, you know. I could pick overeating, but let's talk about smoking right now, okay? What's wrong with me? Why? It could be anything. Kenneth Hagin, one of his was worry. You know, he come to those verses, it says, cast the whole of your care upon the Lord. Another one says, be not anxious about anything, but so forth. He said, well, Lord, I can't do that. I am a worrier raised by champion warriors. I can't not worry. He didn't know what was wrong with him, and the Lord had to deal with him, see. But because we're really not separated out that we can see, you know, I can't go analyze. To me, I'm just me. Well, I've got these problems, and even when I intellectually know I have knowledge, I shouldn't be doing that, and then I don't want to do that, But I keep doing that. You know, this is really the dilemma of the guy in Romans 7. But see, we're born again. We shouldn't have that same dilemma. Well, part of it is we've not been taught right. We're getting better, aren't we? Thank God for Pastor Dave, Born Again Trail. And what he's doing with me here recently, he's bringing this more in a visual way. And if you're able, let me just say to those listening, we're going to have this video available. I'll do my best to try and say what I'm doing here, but these messages recently are way better seen than heard. And if you have a chance, watch the video. They go on YouTube. Click the link, and it'll take you there. Anyway, well, thank God for 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, right there near the end. That's how we know. I pray God that he sanctify you wholly, wholly, moving these further apart for a reason this time, that your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord. Well, you know, the world doesn't even understand that. I was required to take some psychology classes. They don't even understand that you are a spirit. You know what they call the spirit? They call it the subconscious. Mm-hmm. That's right. They don't even understand. Even the modern, with all their knowledge, they're still not up to where the Bible was thousands of years ago. No, that's not you don't have a subconscious. You don't find that in the Word of God. And no, you're a spirit. Okay, yes, sir. I'm just going to follow him, okay? Because that's best. We're going to review. Yes, sir. Bring up another chair. Now, for benefit of those that can't see what I'm doing, I'm all walking up on the platform, and I'm getting a much nicer chair that has arms on it. This is to represent Jesus in heaven, his throne, seated at the right hand of God. And I'm lining him up behind the spirit chair. Because when you get born again, it's his nature that you get. It's Christ in you. Now, what did Dave tell us? Do we have a little bitty Jesus running around on the inside of us, you know? No. It's just like when you were born from your mother's womb. You had the spirit of Adam. You had that fallen spirit. You didn't have a little Adam running around on the inside of you, but you had his nature, right? Well, when you get born again, you get the very nature of Christ. And we've been to Genesis 1 several times, where three times in two consecutive verses, when God repeats himself three times in two consecutive verses, I think it's important. And he says, in the image of God created he man. So even in the garden, when he first made Adam, Christ, Hebrews chapter 1 tells you, Christ is the express image of God. And three times in two verses in Genesis 1, 26 and 27, he says, in the image of God made he man. So we know that originally man had the nature of Christ. He was righteous and holy, and he could walk upright. God gave him his word. Don't eat all these trees, you can eat of the fruit, but that one right there, the very day that you eat it, you shall surely die. Well, you know what happened. Nathan was referring to this in this morning's service. God's going, I wish you to believe me, Adam. I wish you to just believe me and obeyed my word. But Adam didn't. He was tempted by the woman. Well, the woman was deceived. Let's don't say it that way. The Bible does not lay sin at the feet of Eve, because she was deceived. Adam was not. He made a choice with full knowledge that he was disobeying God. Boy, I'm glad I have never done that. Anyway. I'm teaching. I'm not lying. Okay. I'm making a point, okay? So let's do this again. So what happens? What happens? Man's spirit, it says, by one man's transgression, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. We tend to think that the only thing needed was forgiveness. I used to wonder that myself. God, why all this with Jesus dying on the cross and all? I mean, couldn't you just forgive Adam? And did you know it was a long time before I found out he did? Remember those animal skins? It said he clothed Adam and Eve with skins. Where did he get those skins? Something innocent had to die. already pointing towards the day when the Lamb of God would come. He forgave them. But God's looking at this. You say, I want to bring up another chair. I didn't do this last time. Why didn't you? He hadn't showed it to me yet. You think you guys get tired of seeing this vision? You don't know how many times I see it. You bring up another throne for those that can't see. Now, what I did is I moved that spirit chair that was originally made in the image of God, and I brought it all the way down, and I lined it up with the flesh chair. See, we know sin entered into the flesh also. It took about 900 years, but the flesh eventually died, didn't it? So we know death entered into it. We also know that death entered into man's spirit, and he became a different creature, no longer made in the image of Christ, in the image of God. So the question is, whose image was he made in? For additional tapes by Gary Carpenter. No, I didn't know either. What did he say to the Pharisees? You are of your father, the devil. When I saw that, since I taught this the last time, all these things, verses and things that Dave has taught us just lined up in my mind. Things that I've heard Dave say. He'd say, the devil, he has no access to you through your spirit if you're born again. He only has access to you through your flesh. It's the appetites and lusts of the flesh. Anything that's not yet been transformed to the mind of Christ, that's how the devil has access to you. That's the end of the old covenant. He had access to pretty much the whole man because of the spirit and the flesh agreed. That's why, and again, I'm going faster than I have in the past, but God's looking at this situation and he's going, this is way more than forgiveness. I'll kill these animals and forgive, pointing to the day when Jesus will die for them. But I don't want to just forgive them and leave them like that. That's not the way I made man, made in the image of Satan. No, I'm going to forgive you. But son, I want you back the way that I originally made you. That's why the new birth, that's why Jesus had to die, not only to provide forgiveness, but that new nature could once more be created on the inside of us. And once again, it's Genesis 1 all over again. When you get born again, you are created in the very image of God, in the very image of God. We'll get to that again in a minute. But under that old system where man's spirit and man's flesh agreed, sin was good, adultery was good, and man didn't even know it was wrong. That's the thing. That's why the guy in Romans 7, see what God did under the law, I'm folding this up like a scroll. This represents now the Ten Commandments, the law. What did the guy in Romans 7 say? He said, I wouldn't even have known coveting was wrong, except your law said, here comes the law. What part of man did he give it to? No, he didn't. He gave it to his mind, to the soul of man. With the guy in Romans 7, so perfect. He says, with my mind, I agree that your law is good. So what part of man did God give his law to? The mind of man. I was preaching along this. I didn't have this vision down so well then, but I was preaching along this line a few years ago, and a preacher friend of mine in South Carolina, most of you'd know it's Wayne Horn. I love Wayne. Wayne, he goes, my God, Brother Gary, my God, you mean under that old covenant, the mind of man was the best part of man? Yes, sir. And at that time, that's all God really had to deal with, was the power of the mind, the will, the emotions. How many of you know that system didn't work very well? Try as they might. This is the guy in Romans 7. He has received God's law with his mind. And it's not that he doesn't love God. He says, I want to do it. I want to obey it. But it's like two against one. You might obey it for a little while. But sooner or later, what you really are, fallen in spirit, a sinful creature made in the image of Satan, sooner or later, that old man's going to overpower again. There's not enough power in the mind to keep God's law. Nathan said it a couple of times. The law is spiritual. The soul, till it's renewed, is carnal. There's no power there to keep a spiritual law. Is that good stuff or what? More to come on that, I know. All right. How am I doing, Nathan? Am I doing okay so far? Now, what happens to the guy in Romans 7? That's really all they had under the old covenant. And he says, he's wretched man that I am. He says, God, I keep trying this. The thing that I'm never going to do that again, God. Winds up doing it again. Oh, and what I'm going to start doing that good thing. I really am. But eventually he never did get around to doing that either. And that's why he cries out. It's the dilemma of sinful man trying to please or serve or walk with a holy God. Oh, wretched man that I am. Who shall deliver me from this body of death? Can you see the dilemma? Thank God for Romans chapter 8. Because Romans chapter 8, this is the change from the old covenant to the new. This is the man. Now what happens instantly? And for benefit of those that can't see me, I've come down to the far end where the fallen spirit and the flesh agreed. Because what happens when you get born again? The prophet Ezekiel, I think it was. Anyway, he prophesied, I'm going to take out that old stony heart. And I'm going to put a heart of flesh on the inside of you. And then the writer of Hebrews says, I'm going to write my law in your mind and in your heart. He's talking about the spiritual mind and the spiritual heart now. I'm going to write my law. Let me go get the law again. Instead of giving it to the mind, he's talking about the spiritual mind. He's talking about this new creature. I forgot to bring it. I was going to bring a empty Valentine's heart candy box. I forgot to bring it. Because can you imagine God giving his law to a creature that's not love? The law can be really strict, can't it? It's like death. We'll get into that another time. It is the ministry of death given to a person that's not made out of love. But see, God doesn't change. It is his law. But this time, I was going to take this little scroll that represents the law, put it inside that Valentine heart box, and place it right here. You ever receive correction from a neighbor compared with correction from your mother? A little boy breaks a window out next door, accidentally, hits a ball, breaks a window. The neighbor comes out. Gives correction. You broke my window. No. Mother comes out, gives the same correction. The boy does need instruction. But the love that it's ministered with is not tearing you down. It's building you up. And that's the difference between the law trying to be operated through a mind compared with the law operated through the Spirit of God. It is the law. It doesn't change. But the Spirit it comes in is altogether different. That was worth coming right there, wasn't it? It was for me, too. I wish I'd have remembered the heart candy box. I'll bring it next time. But isn't that perfect? It's God's law, but in love now. See, and that's why love is the fulfilling of the law. Because love will work no ill toward its neighbor. If I love Mike Quitmeyer over there, I'm not going to covet Mike's stuff. I mean, I might admire his truck. Be honest with you, I have admired his truck. He's got a nice truck. And the Lord doesn't care if I get me a truck, but I just can't covet Mike's. You understand? Okay. All right, we got to move on now because he's got some specific things to do. I'm going to need this. Do y'all understand now the heart of love? All right. Now, here's the thing. Up until this time, let me get some verses here. Let me remind you of this. So I actually never read 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Let me read it. The very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I said earlier, when I had the chairs lined up in a row, it's really hard sometimes to distinguish between your spirit and your soul. Flesh is a little easier, but even that's not always easy. But the Bible will allow you to tell what you're functioning out of. Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God, and that's logos, for the word of God is quick, it's alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrows, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. You do not have a subconscious. You have a spirit. No, actually, you are a spirit. What is God? God is a
spirit.
If you're his child, what are you?
Spirit.
You have a soul, and you live in a body. Now, when you got born again, we ought to go to, you know, I've done it so many times, you ought to know it by heart. Ephesians 4:22 through 24 says, put off the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and put on that new man, which after God, it means in his image, is created. And that means, look it up in the Greek, instantly, bam, that moment you got born again, there is a new creature on the inside of you that is righteous and holy, made in the image of God. And that, his voice, the voice of that man, is your conscience. And that's how God writes his law into your, that new fleshy heart of you. That he's prophesying about the spirit man. He comes with a conscience. Nobody has to tell you it's wrong to steal if you're born again. I like to use this illustration because it's extreme. You could be a headhunter, grow up in Borneo, and maybe all your life they've told you to become a man, what you have to do, here's the right thing to do, son. You have to go kill one of our enemies and bring his head back. And you always thought that was the right thing to do because for generations, that's the way it's been done. That's the way your daddy did it and the way his daddy did it. And you're about that age now to become a man and you're in training on how to go kill your enemy. And then Nathan comes through and preaches Christ. I'm not prophesying you to Borneo, but somebody preaches Christ and him crucified, and you literally get born again, and that's all you know. You never picked up a Bible in your life, but you genuinely got born again. Bam, a new creature comes on the inside of you, and the next day you set out to kill your enemy. And there's a voice. There's a conscience. It's not always a literal voice, is it? You know how your conscience works. Boy, it communicates. It is effective. And you know, something on the inside says, love your enemy. What? Thou shalt not kill. It doesn't come with Charlton Heston's voice. But it communicates, doesn't it? And you know, I can't do this. Something on the inside of me is constraining me. Something, what is this? It's the voice of your conscience. And that's the voice, that conscience is exactly what Paul was writing about in Romans chapter 2, I believe it is. Is it? Where he says, hey, look, if the Gentiles, they get born again and without the law, they're, in other words, they were never taught the law, but they're keeping the righteousness of the law. How are they doing that? Well, it's their conscience. Either excusing, in other words, this is okay, or accusing, this is not okay. And you get it instantly when you're born again. All right? Are we in agreement so far? This is pretty basic stuff, right? Now, here's the problem. See, the way I always have, this is the difference from the last time. Okay. Adjustment, slight adjustment. Do you notice what didn't get saved? Your flesh did not get saved. I hate to tell you this, your flesh still agrees with the devil. My flesh, it only has one, it has a conscience, I guess. It has a voice. Boy, my flesh has a strong voice. It says, go to Krispy Kreme. Let's worship at the temple of Krispy Kreme. You know. And the first dozen are always good. By the time you finish the second dozen, you're maybe getting four. I don't know. My flesh is like that. It has certain mottos. Here's the flesh. If it feels good, do it. The flesh loves the highs that come from endorphins and pleasures. That's why it's so easy to get caught up with nicotine. For years, I didn't even know how to function without nicotine. How in the world? I started when I was 14. I didn't know what it's like to function as an adult. How do you function? You know, now I know, thank God. But, you know, what if I was, thank God I never was on heroin. But I imagine that's pretty tough. The flesh likes any kind of pleasure. It likes highs. It likes the approval of man. It likes, I'm not, now if my eyes meet yours at any point, it's a total accident, okay? I'm not preaching to you. Don't, he was looking right at me. I'm looking at everybody. Okay. But your flesh likes, so here's another one. What's mine is mine. And what's yours is mine. That's coveting, see? And it thinks, you know what, the flesh, I'm talking the flesh on any person, Christian or not. It thinks adultery is a wonderful thing if you can get away with it. Your flesh, I don't care if you've been saved 35 years, your flesh left on its own would kill your enemy. It would. You know, that's why God looked at us. He says, now I can rebirth their spirit. I'll give them a way to renew their mind. And that's really, today we're talking about saving the soul. Okay, it comes, part of that is renewing the mind. But he looked at our flesh and he goes, even I can't do anything with that. I just declare it dead. And later I'll just have to give him a new one. This rascal has to be on the cross every day or you're not going to live a successful Christian life. Gary, who are you preaching that to? Gary. You can join in if you want to, but I'm preaching it to Gary. It has to go on the cross because it's crazy. It's lost. It's selfish to the max. It only wants what makes it feel good. It loves escape. The flesh is a coward, runs from problems. Take me to the movies. Who are you preaching to? Gary. You know, sedate me with something so I don't have to think about this anymore. Who are you preaching to? Gary. You know, that's the way the flesh is. Now, I will say this because I've been through it quite a bit. It can be retrained where it doesn't crave certain things as much as it used to. We're going to get into this in a minute. I was a literal alcoholic for about 10 years. Didn't know how to function without alcohol either. But I had my last drink 30 years ago, over 30 years ago, 1980. My flesh, and it doesn't bother me about it anymore. Do you know I could train it again? It's much like an animal. I could train it. I could train it to like alcohol again if I want to. I don't want to. But let's talk about nicotine because that's more recent. I never knew what it was like to live free of nicotine. I mean, how did you handle the pressures of life? You know, it sedates you, you know. And usually you don't have hallucinations and stuff, so you can live, you know. But it sedates you. And boy, any little pressure at all, flip, boy. That first 6 months, who knows? I'm exaggerating. It's almost had to buy new shirts because I kept wearing the old ones out, reaching for the pocket where the cigarettes was, you know. Here I'm not smoking them 100 times a day. Some little pressure. And boy, I'm reaching for that cigarette, you know, and it's not there. You know what I put there instead? A New Testament. Little pocket New Testament, and I'd get it, and go, oh yeah, I quit. Boy, it was hard though, and my flesh told me countless times, I will kill you. I'll make your life so miserable, I will kill you. You won't be able to preach. Your wife's going to leave you. You know, you're going to be a miserable human being, and I was. For a long time. But now, it's been way over a decade now. You know, it doesn't bother me anymore. And it even still surprises me sometimes. We'll go through something where pretty stressful, really stressful. And maybe a week, you know, and then it's over. And maybe a week later, I go, hey, it'll dawn on me. I never slapped my chest once. I never even thought of a cigarette. See, the flesh can be retrained. But let me tell you, I also know I can train it again if I want to. That thing has to be kept on the cross. Enough? All right. Yes, sir. Now, this is what's new. Let me read my verses again. We're pretty well up to speed. The service I did on February 4th here is called Conquering by the Spirit. If you did not hear that, you need to hear that one. Because in that message, I used the actual example that the writer of Hebrews used to show the difference between the spirit and the soul. And the example he used, he plainly says they were not able to enter in because of their unbelief. They did not mix faith with the word that they heard. And so what he was using was the spies. And so I'm not going to preach that again. But if you want to see the best message that the Bible uses to illustrate the difference between your spirit and your soul, I really recommend you listen to that one, Conquering by the Spirit. So let me summarize by saying this. There were 12 spies that went in. 10 of the spies are a type of the soul. 2 of the spies are a type of the spirit. That's Joshua and Caleb. It's important to get this now. They all observed the same facts. They all saw the same thing. And everything that they said was true except the conclusion. The sons of Anak did live there. They were giants. The people did live in fortified stronghold cities. He mentions the Canaanites, the Jebusites, all the other sites. And they were all famous for being a fierce and warlike people. That's why they mention them there. So the soul observes those facts and comes to a conclusion that God calls an evil report, even though it's factual. But what made it an evil report is that the conclusion they come to was opposite of what God said. The conclusion that the soul comes to. See, and really this is, you got to understand, God made your soul like this. Your soul is supposed, the soul is an amazing, wonderful thing. See, our flesh really, except unless you get a goosebump once in a while in a Holy Ghost meeting. Normally, your flesh is just designed to operate in the physical world. If you want to know the truth of it, your spirit is not even from this world. Your spirit is from heaven. It's in contact with God. The soul is an amazing thing. I'm talking specifically the mind. It is able to function in both realms. Your mind can listen to your flesh. Do we need any proof of that? No. Okay, good. I'm in the right church. Honest people. But your soul can also hear from God. But God originally designed the soul of man to be the servant of the Spirit. And it's supposed to observe things on the earth. It's supposed to, when you come to the intersection and you look to the left and you look to the right. And when you look to the left, the bus is coming. Your soul is supposed to tell you, don't step in front of the bus. It's supposed to do that. And the soul, man, it's able to do calculations. It's able to do chemistry. It's able to do all kinds of things in this world. But the soul is also able to hear from God. Getting back to that example, conquering by the Spirit. So the 10 spies, they saw the facts and they came to this conclusion. We be not able to take the land. Well, that's the way your soul is normally. Most people, they're pretty good at walking with God till they hear God. Because once you really hear him, whatever he's going to say is probably going to require him to do it with you. See? You're pretty good at walking with God till you hear God. And then you hear him and you go, you're in the same dilemma that they were. This is too big for me. God goes, I'm glad you understand that. You're not going alone. See, but the soul, just like them, without God, the soul goes, we can't do that. I can't stop sinning. I can't this. I can't forgive that person. I can't this. On and on and on, whatever it is, the soul says, I can't. Joshua and Caleb are a type of the spirit, or you could say the renewed mind, either way. Okay? They were a type of the spirit. You know what they said? God is with us. We are well able to take the land. Let us go up at once and possess it. And faith is always now. Whew. Preaching good. Good with Norval kick. Glory to God. See, and later on in Hebrews, this is Hebrews 4, where I'm getting these. Later on, by the time you get to Hebrews 10, and he goes, you know, the writer, he started off with that foundation. In Hebrews 10, he says this verse. We are not of them who draw back under perdition, but of them that believe. Now notice how he words this. To the saving of the soul. Isn't that interesting? And if you look it up, you know, at first you might think, no, no, it's my spirit that got saved. But if you look it up, that word soul there is psuche. It's definitely talking about where we would get the word psychology. He's talking about more than just the mind. If he meant just the mind, there's a word for the mind. It's N-O-U-S. But he said, no, the psuche. Well, that includes the mind, the emotions. That's where strongholds live, if you want to know the truth, the soul. Did you know there's no strongholds in your spirit? Amen. No. All this stuff is in the soul. So now I'm going, Lord, how do I illustrate this? Oh, and then, yes, sir. Okay, up until now, I've always had these chairs equally spaced. But that's really not the condition of the human being when you get born again. Your soul, be honest with you, now, for benefit of those that can't see me, I'm taking the soul, which is the middle chair, and I'm moving it way down here closer to the flesh. Because when you first get saved, I was 33 years old when I got saved. My soul had been walking with my flesh for 33 years. We were what? Sue says, my flesh and my soul, they were buds. That's good. That's real good. Yep. They understood each other. They worked together all the time. But suddenly there's a voice. I got born again. 4th of July, 1980. Because it was on the 4th, I remembered it, you know. 1980, and suddenly there's some other voice on the inside of me preaching from the inside. I'm going to pick some easy ones. For years, my soul and my flesh, and actually my spirit down here, if I had it before I got born again, it thought pornography was just a wonderful thing. I know you look at me now. I did not always look like this, okay? I'm sorry. But in my 30s, before I got saved, I thought pornography was a wonderful thing. I bought the Playboy every month, and in those days, we actually had to have magazines. We didn't have internet. Thank God for that. It's much tougher now, you know. That was bad enough. But I didn't think anything was wrong with that. There was nothing in me except my parents, you know. That's what parents do. They beat an artificial conscience in you. But once you leave home, you know. So here's my soul and my flesh that's worked for 10 years probably, accumulating this really pristine pornography collection of Playboy magazines. And I was so proud of mine, I actually bought the little plastic clear jacket. And I'd show them off. I wouldn't, you know, you come to the house, hey, you want to see my pornography? I never said that to women. I said it to guys, you know. But anyway, I know people are looking at me like, Gary, come on. But it's a good tool. Suddenly, there is a conscience. Immediately, something on the inside of me telling me that pornography's got to go. I'm telling you, my soul, you want to talk about the difference now between your spirit and your soul? My soul argued with that. And it does exactly what the soul does. It started calculating and justifying and coming up with all it. Do you understand how much money we have invested in this? Do you understand I've been collecting this for years and I'm a good steward of this pornography? I've been keeping it in pristine condition. I don't know if those exact, but that kind of argument is going back and forth. Back and forth. Ah, you know, get rid of it. It's got to go. No, get rid of it. No, but I couldn't get any peace. I couldn't, it wouldn't leave me alone. The trouble with the conscience, it doesn't sleep. Your spirit man does not sleep. I might get a little bit of sleep, and I'd wake up, and I'm, you know, thinking, okay, he's probably forgot about that. Wake up, pornography's got to go. Oh, man. As soon as you wake up, you know. And it would just dog me and dog me. It wasn't just a few days. For sometime in the first week, I don't remember exactly. I didn't keep as good a records in. But sometime even in the first week, bundled it all up, put it in these bags, and away the thing went. With me, now I'm not preaching to you, I'm just telling you about my deal. With me, he started dealing with me about rock and roll music. And because with us, it was an idol. It really was. It was just an absolute idol. And I'd run to that all the time instead of God. It was soothing. I loved it. My soul liked it. And so for me, now he may not at all say it. In fact, he lets me have it now. I've got some of it. I got CCR on my iPhone. Don't write me no letters, okay? But it's not an idol to me now, you know. I mean, I can leave, you know. But then it was, and boy, he would not leave me alone about it. It's got to go. What? Arguing again. Now here's the reason I'm doing this. See, the day that my soul, yes, sir, this is important. For benefit of those that can't see me, I've got my soul, which is the mind and the intellect, scooched right up close to my flesh. But the day that my soul bowed the knee to the new man, and the pornography left the house, my soul got a little saved. My soul, I moved the chair a little closer towards the spirit man and away from the flesh. Now my flesh staying right smack where it was, and it would love to have all that again, and I could train it to want it again. But my soul got a little bit saved. Can I say it that way? It had received, you know, James here, I think I wrote this verse, the way James puts it. James, I've got the whole passage here. Chapter, you don't have to turn to this unless you want to, but James 1, verse 21. It says, wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. I like another, I love the King James, it's Dave here. I love the King James. But a better translation of that is residue of wickedness. Things still left over from your old life that you haven't dealt with yet. And he's saying, put that all away. How do you do it? You receive with meekness. Meekness means teachability. Receive with meekness. Where do I receive it? In my soul. Receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your soul. Here we go again, the saving of the soul. This is really no difference in Romans 12, 1 and 2, that you be no longer conformed to this world, but that you be transformed by the renewing of your, that's, James calls it the saving of the soul, renewing of the mind. It's really the same thing, but it's as your mind is progressively trained by the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, by the conscience, the voice on the inside of you, the more that that every time that soul bows the knee and surrenders and says, you're Lord and I'm not, you're moving a little closer to the spirit man and away from the flesh. You're bringing the flesh under dominion. A little more, a little more, a little more. That word engrafted is so good. It really, another word that would be implanted, but really grafted is better. Because what God did with that, when you got a new nature, it came with the law of God grafted within it. Just like he wrote on tables of stone, this time he wrote on tables of flesh. And when you're born again, his law, his word is engrafted in you. Now, the question is, will your soul receive it with meekness? Sometimes mine has. Sometimes it just resisted like the dickens. With nicotine, it resisted for decades. I'll let you have the pornography. I'll let you have the rock and roll music. Alcohol left, but I'm keeping my nicotine. Did not receive it with meekness, and it came up with all these things. I need it. I need, now I say, it's foolish to me now. It's so silly, the things I used to say. Well, I'd probably be a monster without my nicotine to sedate me. Well, I'd be a monster. I wouldn't be able to control it. I look back at that now and say, well, you stupid soul. You think you know more than God? That's pride. What do you mean nicotine is more powerful than God? Where does my peace come from? Well, then it came from nicotine, apparently. Now my peace comes from God. See, and I like Dave's, that series he has, Peace, the Aggressive Weapon of God. Boy, that's a good title. It's a good, but my soul had to receive with meekness the engrafted word. It has to bow the knee, and it's still in that process of bowing the knee. When he called us, I talked the last time, I think, about when he started talking to us. Here we go again. Oh, I walk real good with God. Yeah, I know you do too. You hear him. When he started hearing him about the ministry and what he wanted us to do and send everything for free, I talked about this the last time. How many of you was here? Heard me talk about Omazanga Wonga Bonga. Remember that guy? How many were not here? Okay, I think everybody's pretty. He just started dealing with about sending everything for free. And my soul, are you kidding? Nobody does that. Every ministry sells their cassette tape. This was in the days of cassette tapes. Everybody sells their cassette tapes. We need money, God. You're trying to instruct God. Do you not understand that we need money? I felt like I would say, have you seen my checkbook? And I felt like he was always saying, have you seen mine? I came so close. Only he and I know how close I came to disobeying that. Because for years, the circumstances lined up with it ain't working. It is not working. It got bad. It got real bad. Boy, I came so close to disobeying him. And it doesn't matter that he wasn't saying the same thing to all the other preachers. See, when I get there, I don't have to give account for Dave's life. I don't have to give account for Benny Hinn's life or anybody else. I'm going to give account for, did I obey him? Here we go again, this morning's message. Did I walk by the conscience? Did I walk by what he told me? See, this where I am now is beyond the conscience. The conscience, this is where you get that immediately. You may not know what you're called to do at that point, but when it comes to the moral compass, right and wrong, this is okay and that's not okay, it is a perfect guide. And it comes full grown in that regard. It knows right from wrong. If you listen to it, you'll be okay. But the new nature, the conscience, does not know the plan of God for your life. It doesn't even know if you're a pastor, a prophet, a teacher, or helps, or governments. It doesn't know any of that. Where does that come from? Jesus, who sits on the throne. He gave some apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers. He decides who you are. He decides what part in the body you're supposed to play. Well, how do you find that out? When we know not what to pray as we ought. The Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. He knows the plan of God, and he'll make intercession for you according to that plan. And little by little, it's a download, spirit to spirit. Spirit to spirit. And progressively, as your spirit begins to understand things like mine, I'm going, he wants us to give everything away free. How did I know that? Praying in other tongues and doing exactly what Pastor Davis taught us and learning to locate the ear of my spirit and listen. And it's little by little. I've tried to be really honest with you. You know, he'd say things like, okay, give everything away free. That took forever for my soul to bow the knee to that. So then my soul has another good idea. Okay, we'll put in return envelopes, and at least, you know, that. Well, the very next time I'm praying. Oh, don't put in any return envelopes. My soul had to receive with meekness the engrafted word. And what I told them last time, for those of you that weren't here, years later I got to go to South Africa. And shortening the story, they have squatter camps there that don't have electricity or anything. It's terrible. And I got to meet a man there that who had been receiving tapes from us for years because they were free. And we sent them postage paid. And and he was just so glad to meet me. And he's telling me all about, he spoke English, how his, those teachings had changed his life, and he and his wife were filled with the Holy Ghost now, and they're teaching their kids, and they've blessed everybody. And I'm going, where do you live? And he said, in that squatter camp. I said, well, there's no electricity in the squatter camp. How did you listen to the cassette tapes? He says, oh, I have a friend who has a house. He has electricity. Every time we'd get a set of your tapes, I would let my 20 or 25 friends know, and we'd all gather at that house. And we would listen. We would sit on the floor of his living room, and we'd listen and talk. And if you sent 6 tapes, we listened to all 6 before we go home. When I tell that story, even now, the emotion rises up on the inside of me. I wanted to cry because I know how close I came to letting my soul override that instruction. My soul came so close to being Lord, making the decisions, and boy, I would have to give an account for that. I was so glad. There's no way that man or any of those guys would have ever had those teachings if I'd have charged a penny for them, or if I'd have been unwilling to send them postage paid. They have nothing there. I thank God. And I thank God now today is the internet. They probably go to that same guy's house now and just listen right off the internet by now, you know. But thank God. I don't know what's coming next. He does. See? Where did I lay my hair there? The saving of the soul is progressive. It's not instantaneous like your reborn human spirit. It's a progressive walk. Okay? And where you have problems, where I have had problems, anywhere that I stick my foot in the ground and I say no, it slows everything way down. Like, let's take nicotine again. That's one of them where I really dug my heel in the ground. Even Dave started letting me preach here while I was still smoking. I can't believe he did that. I wouldn't let me. But Dave let me. Something in him, you know. Tim, they let me. And I, you know, and God, you know, and the thing of it is, God, he was dealing with Gary, his son, who is a spirit. Do you know that he has healed cancer through my nicotine-stained fingers? Now, they'll run you out of town on a rail. You preach that in a holiness church. But I saw it happen. I know it happened. And I'm not against holiness. I'm all for holiness. But I'm saying, don't wait till you're perfect to think he's going to use you. I don't know any perfect people. He'll use you now as long as you're walking with him and doing those things that are going to just, you know, eventually get you free. And don't start. I never said smoking was okay. I knew it was wrong. So you got to call sin, sin. Don't say it's okay when it's not okay. And don't think you're special because you pray. It really wasn't that. Yeah, you want to know what it was? I'll show you. I got a perfect illustration. I'd listen to those, David, save me and then kill me. You know what I mean? You're going to let, he'd kill me. You're going to let a little 2-inch, one time I said weed, and Angie told me afterwards, said, don't use the word weed, they'll think it was marijuana. Hey, and she's right. So I'm not using that anymore. No, I never was on marijuana. We're just talking plain old nicotine, cigarette. David preached one of those messages. You going to let a little 2-inch cigarette keep you from walking in victory? And I'd think, no. Until I got to the smoking tower. Y'all know what I mean by that. I'd get about a few, get him a half a mile away, and all of a sudden, here we go again. You know, and for years, you know. And then finally he'd say, you're going to let a little weed like that? No. I'd stomp with myself. I might make it a while. So here's Gary in my soul. I'm sitting in the soul chair. I heard Dave preach, I'm not going to let no 2-inch cigarette keep me from my freedom. I quit. Do you hear me? I quit. My flesh is over here. The flesh that loves nicotine, it's going, I'll be right back. It come right over to Gary in the chair. After about 30 minutes, it's going, don't you think it'd be better just to cut down? cold turkey, you could die. You know, you've been smoking for 40 years, you know. Yeah, maybe I should, my soul, maybe I should cut down. No, 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 I'm not going to do it. I heard Dave, I'm not going to do it. After about an hour, well, just give me one cigarette, the flesh. Just give me one cigarette, you'll be okay. No, not going to give you one. When Norval tells his story about when he quit, he said, something in him said, well, just give me a Chesterfield. And he says, you got to be desperate to want a Chesterfield. Most of you not old enough to remember Chesterfield. But after about two hours, here's my flesh. It's come over to my soul. Gets me by the throat. I will kill you. I mean, it felt like ants crawling under my skin. The withdrawals would come and, and I'm 40-some-odd years, you know, I've lived with this thing. Now, see, you could apply that. I'm a wimp, okay? A lot of people just quit smoking. It's no big deal. I thought I was going to die. I don't know what else to tell you. And maybe you could apply this to whatever you're dealing with. But anyway, it was going to kill me. The withdrawals would be so bad that I'd go back to it. But see, I did not quit doing what we've been taught here. I kept praying, seeking the Lord, obeying Him in other areas. And eventually, the Lord knew what it would take. Now, here's what it took for Gary. This is just what happened, okay? Sue and I were in White Plains, New York. We were doing some meetings up there. And I was praying that night. We had that was a nice motel room. It had a bedroom with a door and had a living room. And I was up about 3 in the morning. I just couldn't sleep. And so I shut the door. Sue was in there sleeping. And in my case, Jesus just walked into the room. He did. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, He was there. I still can't tell you what He looked like. You know how visions are. I knew for sure it was Him. And He just began talking with me. And again, instruction came with such love. It wasn't judgment and thunder and hellfire. It wasn't like that at all. But He began talking to me. I'm sure He was talking. I don't know. At this point, maybe my soul was a little bit better. I don't know. But He's talking here, and I'm hearing it in both realms. All I can tell you, my soul knew what He was saying, even though I know He was communicating with my spirit. But maybe a vision includes the soul. All I know is I saw Him. And He began talking with me like this. And He says, by the way, this is before Sue and I had ever been overseas. We had never been out of the country yet to preach the gospel. And I didn't know we were going. He said to me, He says, you know, you can get it right now. He says, you and I have a good relationship, and you're doing good work for me. If you were to come to heaven right now the way you are, and I knew He was talking about still smoking, then there's going to be a reward for you. He says, but son, there's places where I want to send you that I can't send you if you don't deal with this in the flesh. Because if you don't, they just won't believe anything that you have to say. There's just no point in me sending you because it won't do any good. Now you can still, he didn't force me. He says, even if you choose to continue the way you are, you'll come to heaven, you'll have a good reward. But when you get here, I'm going to have to draw back a curtain. And I'm going to show you all of the things that it was my will for you to do where I could not send you. Because you would not deal with that in the flesh. And that was the end of the vision. The emotions that came into my soul, every time I would think about Him drawing back that curtain, the emotions that came to my soul from that were stronger than the withdrawals from my flesh. Now, the withdrawals were tough. I tell everyone, it was like a year and a half for me before I had it. Those people that say you're free in 7 days or 21 days, those people were never addicted to nothing. I'm telling you right now, they don't know what they're talking about. But it was tough. It was really tough. And I had 1,000 opportunities to go back to the flesh. But every time I would, He had saved my soul with this vision because the emotions attached with Him drawing back that curtain was stronger than the emotions attached with the withdrawals. And thank God I made it. Now, there is the benefit to continue doing those things that will one day spell out your freedom. We don't know why we do the things we do. Somebody might say, well, smoking, you know, big whoop. Well, maybe you're envious. Maybe you're jealous. Maybe you're a gossip. Maybe you're a cheat. Maybe we shouldn't examine your tax returns all that closely. You know? We don't know why we do what we do. But the Holy Spirit also along with that new nature, comes to help us with those infirmities, those weaknesses in the flesh. We don't even know why we do it. He does. And he'll get you free if Jesus has to come walking into your room. I'm telling you, he will get you free. Now, the truth is, you're free the day you got born again.
Amen.
You're free. But what about all his teachings about strongholds in the soul, see? Sometimes those aren't so easily dismissed. It'll never change the truth. You were free the instant you were born again. Saving of the soul. Can you see how this, you know what'll happen? Your soul will start believing. Now, for benefit of those that can't see me, now I'm taking that middle chair and I've moved it past center. More on the spirit side than on the flesh side now. Your spirit will start thinking progressively as you obey him. All things are possible to him that believes. And you obey him a little more and you find out he came through on that deal too. And you pray a little more and you find out he came through on that deal too. Pretty soon, we have the mind of Christ. Pretty soon, you and your spirit man, now they're buds. And your flesh, where is it? It's on the cross. This is walking in the Spirit. When your soul bows the knee, a big part of that renewing of the mind, a big, big part of that is the soul coming to the conclusion, it is not Lord anymore. It taking its proper role as a servant, bowing the knee to the Lord Jesus Christ, is probably the biggest part of renewing the mind. It's not Lord. Lord, whatever you say. Now we're back to Luke 6, about verse 46 or so, where he says, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Well, in the beginning, it's because your soul is buds with the flesh. It still thinks it has a right to speak. Did you hear that? When the soul truly is a servant. Now, it has a right to ask questions. He told me one time, he says, I'll instruct you. So that you'll know what to do in the natural. I'll give you enough to where you know. Who, what, when, where, how. Not always how. And not always why. But when, where, what. Well, your soul has to know that in order to function. But it has to also trust in him. Because I'm telling you right now, the stuff God talks to you about always looks impossible. Because he's always going to be involved with you to take the land. So you don't ever look at the facts and stack them up against God. Excuse me. You don't ever look at the facts and stack them up against you. I'm not able to take it. I'm not able to conquer. That's the way the soul functions. No, you look at the facts and you stack them up against God. Okay, one other passage and we're going to quit. I want to get this one in while I've got your mind here. Another message that I have at the website is called The Unjust Judge. The Unjust Judge, okay? It's in Luke. Don't have to turn there. We don't have time. Let me just read it to you. Luke 18, verse 1 through 8. Now, I'm going to give you the very, very, very abbreviated version of this teaching, and then I'm going to give you a visual, okay? But there's a lot more at the website, and I have two messages together in a series. They're called Truth Changes Fact, and then the other one is The Unjust Judge. Boy, if you haven't heard those, you ought to hear them. So let me just read to you the parable, Luke 18, verses 1 through 8. He spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Faint means quit. Saying, there was in a city a judge. This judge, he feared not God, neither regarded man. Did you get that? There was a widow in that city, and she came unto him saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, now get this, though I fear not God, nor regard man. Yet because this widow troubleth me. Why did he do it? She was bugging him. Relentlessly, she would not stop. The whole parable is pray and not quit. She wouldn't quit. Because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she wearies me. She's wearing me out. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge says, but shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? In other words, he'll do it quick. I tell you, he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on the earth? Now, it was a long time before I understood this. And put the soul down here back when it's buds with the flesh. Let's talk about sickness now. So far, we've been talking about sin and righteousness and that type of thing. Let's talk about when sickness attacks your bate. And in Tulsa, it's your bate. Okay. Yeah. And the body, I mean, there's pain. Pain is a relentless preacher. Have you noticed? The soul of man, to be honest, in that parable there, that unjust judge is not like God. You notice it said it did not fear God or man? And the only thing that made it render a different verdict was the preponderance of evidence that was presented to it. That widow would not quit. She would not quit. She would not quit. And the soul's going, or the unjust judges, well, this woman's wearing me out. Just to get her to shut up. Plain English. I'm going to render a verdict. Now watch this. Your soul is the unjust judge. What makes it an unjust judge? It doesn't regard God or man. It will receive evidence from any source, whether it's truth or fact. See, facts are facts. And like Ronald Reagan said, facts are stubborn things. That's true. But facts are not truth. What is truth? Jesus gave us the definition of truth for all eternity. Father, thy word is truth. Truth will change facts. The 10 spies presented the facts. God's truth caused them to promise the land in spite of the facts. It overcame the facts. And that's what his word always does. Now watch this. Watch this. The saving of the soul. Ow! The body goes, ow! I've got pain in my left kneecap. My elbow, my foot, whatever it is. You go to the doctor. And they're supposed to give you a factual report. We put them in jail if they do not. Don't blame the doctor. That's what they're supposed to do. My knee hurts. It's because it's broken. Okay. Or whatever. I could pick anything. The point is, your pain is a relentless preacher. It is preaching to your soul all the time. It is this way. It is a lawyer presenting evidence. I want to use, instead of kneecap, let's just say sick. You feel bad. So this feelings of feel bad constantly being presented to the soul. So the soul renders a verdict. By this pain, we are sick. I'm sick. See, that's the way the soul would talk. Isn't that right? And the soul, without the Spirit of God, that's what it's designed to do. Move by what it sees. Move by, don't step in front of the bus. We have pain. We are sick. Okay? But see, it says only the Word of God can separate soul from spirit. Your spirit man, what does it believe? Is it moved by what it sees? Is it moved by what it feels? Do you know it's going to be preaching right back at that soul? By his stripes, we were healed. He blesses our bread, blesses our water. He takes sickness away from the midst of us. Himself bore our sicknesses and carried our pains. Now the thing of it is, James there a while ago, I should have read that last. Oh, I still got it, don't I? Before he concludes that little teaching over there about the saving of the soul, he says, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not the tongue, but deceives his own heart, that man's religion is in vain. Vain just means it won't do nothing. It won't produce nothing. So it comes down to this. The soul, that part of you that renders decisions, it's an unjust judge. What makes it unjust, again, is it will receive evidence from any source, whether it's fact or truth. Pain is a relentless preacher, or feelings of sickness, relentless. Ow, ow, and then again, ow. So we want to bridle our tongue so that our religion will be useful and productive. So we say maybe once every 3 days, by his stripes, I was healed. Now I'm going to teach it like this. So when you did that, you brought a document to the soul from the Spirit, from God, we're healed. And for the next hour, the flesh preacher goes, sick, 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 really sick, feel bad, probably going to die, okay? Better call the hospital now. Maybe the ambulance will get here in time. You're sick. Sick, 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 sick. You feel that? Feel that right there. Feel that. Oh, yeah, feel that. I told you you're sick. Three hours later. Oh, bridle my tongue. I'm presenting evidence. Himself bore my sickness and carried my pains. Sick, 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 sick. The judge is going to render a verdict based on who's wearing it out. Now, who's wearing it out? It's listening to the flesh preacher. He says, I'm going to render a verdict, and this guy over here is wearing me out. Done. I don't fear God or man. Done. Shut up. Leave me alone. You see it? The saving of the soul involves the bowing. I don't care what you see. I don't care what you feel. The soul has to bow the knee to the Spirit and say, whatever you say, that is truth. Did you get anything out of that? Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. 5 minutes till 12. That was a lot. That was a lot. That's simple. I hope the simplicity of it doesn't take away from the power of it. But that's how you retrain the soul. That's the saving of the soul. You've got to receive with teachability this engrafted word. And we could use it here. I used it on sickness, and we used it on finances some. It's the same with walking in holiness and righteousness, because your flesh is still going to want to go do stuff. It wants to get even. It wants to get vengeance. It wants a high. It wants what? Oh, I thought she said it wanted to fast. Mine never wants to fast. No, what she said was it wants it immediately, quickly. Yeah, okay, I understand that. My flesh never yet has said, we should go on a fast. Never once has it ever said that. Glad we got that straight. But I'm telling you, the soul can be saved in the sense of renewed to where it says, let's get it all the way over here. When your soul and your spirit man really become buds and you have renewed your mind, which is possible. Yes. Now, that does not mean the flesh is not going to tempt you. Because the flesh, I'm so clear to me now, that's why it has to be on the cross. Say, it has to be on the cross. But you can come to the place where your spirit and your soul are such buds walking in the same light. It's not hard for me anymore, flesh, no nicotine today. What? It doesn't even really say that anymore. I don't even think about it anymore. Other things, we're still working on. Gary, what are they? None yet. And they're none of your business either. You know, I'm not asking about your stuff now, am I? Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for taking complex things and getting them down simple enough that we can understand them, Lord. Father, every person that hears this, I know right now they're thinking, Lord, I want my soul to bow the knee. I think all of us, Lord, are tired of following our soul. It's a misguided rascal. It doesn't know the plan of God. It doesn't even know right from wrong unless it's been trained and taught by your Spirit and by your Word. Father, each and every one of us here, whether they're physically here or around the world hearing, Father, give us more grace. Your Word says, to the humble, you give more grace. Father, right now, each and every one of us, we're humbling ourselves. With all we know how, we're bowing the soul and saying, Lord, you alone are Lord. Help me learn to walk by my Spirit. In Jesus' name we all pray. Everyone says, amen. Amen.